might help if I have my microphone on. Live TV, folks, I tell you.
Yeah.
That's, let me clip that on here. We are talking about MidAmeriCon 1976 with the organizer, Ken Keller. And give me a little bit of a sense of perspective, because we were talking before you got on about the fact that this is now in a big convention center.
Right.
Early days of Worldcon, these kind of conventions, they were all in hotels, the ballrooms, and that sort of thing.
Sure.
Coming into this one, 40 years after the first one, what's different, what's the same?
Well, what is the same is the knowledge that I had then that we were very soon going to be going into a convention center. In fact, 2 years later, in 1978, the Phoenix, Arizona Worldcon, IguanaCon, was the first convention center-based Worldcon. It was easy to see, if you were a convention organizer, that with the growth of science fiction and the number of fans attending conventions, that we would soon have to go to a convention center in order to be able to do all of the events that we wanted. In fact, Kansas City was one of the last of the complete hotel-based Worldcons. Now, there have been a few, I should interject, since then, that had hotels large enough to have Worldcons in hotels. Chicago, the last couple of ShyCons, have been hotel-based because they have huge hotels that can actually hold the modern Worldcon. But for the most part, they're being held in convention center. And I predicted this in one of our progress reports, saying it was not going to be too long in the future before we will be in convention centers.
Now, how much of a difference does something like that make? I mean, is it more intimate in the hotels? I mean, you've got the panel rooms and such where you've got standing room only, I'm hearing, and you know that sort of thing. And there's not a whole lot of really crowded space here on the floor.
Well, the big difference was in that era, there weren't 15 to 18 tracks of programming happening simultaneously. At the 34th Worldcon 40 years ago, we had about four tracks happening simultaneously, not counting the 18-hour-a-day film program that we were running. And even then, that was quite a bit of programming for people to select from. Our main programming ran on the half hour. So you could sample a program. If you didn't care for it, there would be another one starting within a half hour after that. And that technique worked very well. But once we moved into convention centers and the crowds became larger, then you had to start programming for a much larger and more diverse audience. Back in 1976, science fiction was in a huge growth spurt, period. Since the previous Missouri Worldcon in 1969, which had about a 1,400-person attendance, another couple thousand people had been added to the Kansas City Worldcon just 7 years later.
Right.
And that changed the whole dynamic of what a modern convention then was like. And as I pointed out, it would be the time of the convention center-based Worldcon was coming. It was easy to see.
How much of a difference does that make in deciding what kind of programs you have? Because we've been looking at the program book,
right,
trying to decide what panels we're going to get to, and you know, we're sitting here saying, you know, we need a staff of 20 or 25 just to get to all the panels because there's so much going on every hour.
Right.
Is there too much, or is that a deliberate...
Well, my own personal feeling is that even a modern Worldcon with 4,000 or 5,000 people attending doesn't need as large a variety of programming that it has. But that's my personal opinion.
Right.
Executing a program of that complexity takes a tremendous amount of effort. Even doing it the way we did it 40 years ago took a tremendous effort. One of the things that happens with a smaller number of programs is that you will definitely get less variety, but you'll get larger turnouts at those panels.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're more focused. And it's only up to the people who are attending the convention to decide if that's a good or a bad thing. Personally, I'd like to see us return to the more focused type of programming. Rather than having 20 people or 30 people in an audience, we have 150 people for a specific program. But that said, we began planning for just the eventuality that you see today. We had more programming at our Worldcon than most regional conventions had at that time, and certainly more than most Worldcons.
Now, I was talking to Ruth Lickvart on Thursday, I think it was, and we were talking about attendance. And she said Wednesday's warm body count was somewhere around 3,000, which is very...
That's about what it felt like, yeah.
Than what they were expecting. Overall, does it feel like this is a bigger crowd, bigger than usual crowd, or is this what everyone expected?
It's hard to say because we're having this convention in the largest convention space that a U.S. Worldcon has ever been held in, and that's going to make it, in some senses, feel smaller and more spread out. So I think that's probably more of a subjective approach. If we were in a smaller facility, it would feel more crowded. And because there's a constant ebb and flow back and forth between all of the programming, you see a lot of the convention constantly on the move. So you don't really get a strong sense of how large the convention is. But I thought at 3,000 roughly, and I knew what the advance attendance figures were like, but you can never predict how many people are going to come at the door and pay a one-day or two-day membership, which Worldcon allows. I knew that prior to this convention, there were somewhere around 4,000 full convention memberships sold. And I say memberships because rather than passes or tickets, when you join the World Science Fiction Convention, you were actually joining the World Science Fiction Society, which is a membership organization, and this convention is the convention for the members of the World Science Fiction Society.
Now, we've been talking about that on a previous episode of one of our podcasts, mm-hmm. about just what the World Science Fiction Society does outside of deciding where WorldCon happens,
right,
and
site selection,
and choosing the Hugo winners.
Hugos.
What else do they do? I mean,
they have to. There's the Mark Protection Committee that protects the term Hugo Award,
right.
The term World Science Fiction Convention or WorldCon, and they stringently have to defend those in order to keep the trademark active.
Right.
They have to do that. The business meetings that are held every day during a WorldCon, the preliminary and national business meetings, set the trends for changing the WorldCon Constitution and the Hugo rules. Beyond that, WorldCons are pretty much independently organized events by the local convention committees, but there is also a floating WorldCon committee, mm-hmm. of people from all over the country that staff and volunteer every WorldCon, regardless of where it is. And that very concept started with my WorldCon back in 1976. I called it my team of experts. I knew that our committee did not have all of the necessary skills that I wanted to implement, and we implemented 25 new things that had never been done before at a WorldCon. And I knew that I would need a greater, more experienced convention committee to implement that.
Right.
And so as a trial run, a trial balloon, I recruited people from various parts of fandom to do specific functions. And this is a concept that took hold and has been a part of the World Science Fiction Convention ever since.
So does that present the fact that there's not a very large group of people that are consistently involved all the time, does that present a challenge in marketing or presenting WorldCon? Because we were at Kansas City Comic Con last week, and there were a number of people that gave the impression that they thought MidAmeriCon 2 and WorldCon were completely separate events. There's this notion out there that WorldCon is it's a foreign thing for some people, even within fandom,
right?
Because there's not a big push on social media or YouTube or on the marketing side of things to get that brand awareness out like you would see in other places. I know that the
right.
Helsinki people, instead of calling their convention HellCon or whatever,
or HellCon,
they're saying it's going to be WorldCon 75.
Well,
and they're just going with that name.
The tradition from the first WorldCon in 1939 in New York City was called the World Science Fiction Convention. Its nickname became Nikon,
right?
And the nicknaming concept slowly took hold. The next WorldCon, the second WorldCon, was in Chicago and became known as ShyCon, but it was the second World Science Fiction Convention. And over the years, its formal title and its popular title, or popular name, became interlinked. And this is where the confusion is caused. If we were simply known as this convention is the 74th World Science Fiction Convention,
right.
not MidAmeriCon 2.
It would seem like that would be easier to market.
That would be easier to market.
This is WorldCon.
But the long tradition that exists now is that each WorldCon has that name identifier in addition to its formal title. One's a formal name, World Science Fiction Convention. This
right.
is the 74th World Science Fiction Convention. but it is also MidAmeriCon too, just as mine was the original MidAmerica. And we discussed this issue 40 years ago, but it wasn't as confusing or as big an issue now because science fiction is so universally popular. Right. It wasn't then.
Sure. But in this day and age now, where you've got so many different ways of communicating with the general public, you know, you've got Facebook and Twitter and all the social media, all the digital media. We've got all of this on-demand video and online stuff. Would it make more sense to be more consistent from year to year and promote Worldcon over the
its nickname or unofficial title? I think so. That would be correct. And we would be returning to our original roots if we were to do so.
Right.
But there's strong Fanish tradition to call the convention by both its names, its formal names. Well, you have the term Worldcon, which is short for World Science Fiction Convention. You have the popular nickname of the convention itself, which helps designate its region. And then you have the formal title World Science Fiction Convention. And then you have the number associated with that World Science Fiction Convention. So you're juggling lots of different balls. And it is confusing to outsiders who don't understand the nomenclature. I don't know what the answer is to that. I don't think Worldcon's ever been too concerned with promoting a brand name.
Right.
It has kind of the attitude that since it is the grandfather of all fan conventions, I believe it says, we exist, we're here, if you're interested, look us up. I think this is wrong. I think there should be more branding done to help identify Worldcon from all the vast number of other conventions that are happening out there. But that's my personal opinion.
Sure. Now, with this convention being associated with the Hugo Awards, we've had controversy over the last few years about the Hugos, which has led to conversations about the relevance of the Hugos. Some people are sitting there saying, well, it's a Hugo Award, that doesn't mean anything anymore, as much as it used to.
Well, I don't believe that, because this controversy is only 2 years old.
Right.
The Hugos have existed since 1953. That's a long history that can be looked up, and you can see all of the various winners. The Worldcon business meetings right now are dealing with this in terms of new rules that are going to be adopted and put in place to keep the kind of ballot box stuffing that has been happening the last couple of years from happening again. In other words, protecting the Hugo from outside forces who wish to distort its meaning.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of politics involved in this, but I won't want to get into that. But remember, the Hugo Award is science fiction's oldest award.
Right.
But among all of the awards that are given in science fiction, there's more than 70 of them now. And so there's a vast array of awards being given. We have the Nebula Award given by the Science Fiction Writers of America. We have the World Fantasy Award, which is given by the FantasyCon. We have the World Horror Award, and many, many, many others.
And there's the New Dragon Award.
And that's yet to be seen how that's going to work out. I think there's some problems with the counting measures. They possibly have opened themselves up to the same kind of ballot box stuffing that we've seen the Hugo subject to the last couple of years. How this will all wash out will depend on the adoption of new rules for voting that are right now being considered by the business meetings at this convention that will be passed on to Worldcon 75 in Helsinki.
All right. Ken Keller, thanks very much.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me on the show.